Good morning. Can I hear it for J.S. Fu? Yeah, that makes me alive. I think most of you got tired seeing this banana for a pretty long time. All I asked was for a banana. Right? And what I got was a gorilla holding the banana. Not only that, I got the entire forest. This is what Joe Armstrong, the father of Erlang, said about object-oriented programming. I'm not going to talk about object-oriented programming and why it's bad or if it's working for you, well and good. But today I'm here to talk about going functional with JavaScript. But why JavaScript? As you all know, JavaScript is already a multi-paradigm programming language. It also supports a few functional concepts like functions as first-class citizens, closures, but there are yet more things that we can do with it. And let's see how we can go functional with JavaScript as we proceed. Functional programming is a hot topic, right? I need some conversation here. Very hard. Not really. 1930. Alonzo Church, in 1930, this man, when people were giving talks on set theories and making axioms, and this man said, I'll write functions. And he called it lambda, and that's what lambda calculus. In 1930, there was a proposal for lambda calculus. And anybody know who this is? John McCarthy, yeah, the father of Lisp. He said, you're doing it completely wrong. And he wrote Lisp, which implemented the lambda calculus, which was proposed in 1930. This was in 1970s. And today it's hot. What is functional programming language? Well, there is no single definition. It's like this philosophy of whether the glass is half empty or half full. I would rather say take the glass and drink the water. So there's no single definition, but let's try to define it. Say functional programming is all about, let's take the contrast of what object-oriented programming was. Like you see an object, you feel it, and is an object, has a class, and you derive and whatnot out of it. So something which can be feel and felt, like you can see it in your real life, is an object. So there was this object orientation. So something which is related to process, say you have a file which you read, or you have a file stream which you process it and you get another stream and then you write it to a file. Some process oriented thing is normally could be of functional in nature. Why functional programming language? Obviously you can write cleaner code. Who doesn't want to write a cleaner code here? Right? You can write a cleaner, modular code, which could be composable, testable, and above all of these seven things, like it's mathematically correct. You can see your code and prove it mathematically right even before executing it. Even at the design phase, where you're designing your product or where you have your architecture, if you go the functional way, you can prove it mathematically whether it's right or wrong. You can see where it could fail or where it could succeed, and even before implementing it, that's a huge success, right? Sorry? It must be sleepy, you know, it's awake. All right, so mathematical correctness. So if you have made the projector go functional, or if the projector software was written functional, it would be easier to debug. So we could just go ahead and fix the small function which was causing this issue. I bet it would be an object-oriented. I'm not against it, but yeah. So let's get some of the jargons. That's there, Yoda speaking to Hull. You must get your jargons right, you must, eh? So let's get some functional jargons so that it will be easier when we do the live coding part, all right? This must be pretty familiar for most of you, but I just want to run through if you're not. Arity. Arity is nothing but the number of arguments you pass to the function. Here, I have a small sum function, and it takes two arguments, and hence its arity is 2. Then we have higher order functions. Higher order functions are nothing but functions which can receive functions and functions which can return functions, right? So here is a greet function, which takes a name and returns a function, and on passing higher order to it, it executes the function saying, hello, HOF, higher order functions. Then we have Kering. If you can see the small guy in the picture, it's Haskell Kering. The Kering name is from Haskell. So we have the get color function here, which takes RGBA, as in red, green, blue, and alpha. And the function is called masala, which takes in RGBA, as in this is ES6 notation of arrow functions, where the first function returns another function, and the second function returns the other function, and so on. So what basically currying is if you curry a function, the function will end up returning a function that is waiting for other parameters. As in here we have RGBA, so the masala function returns R, which is expecting G, which is expecting B, which is expecting A. But the getColor function was just RGBA, the arity was 4. So the whole idea is reducing the arity to a single arity, right? That's currying. So if people have, how many of you have heard currying and tried here? So you must be thinking, isn't this a partial application, right? So we need to get our definition right. Partial application is about applying partially the number of arguments that the function take. So for example, here sum takes AB and we are doing A plus B. When we partially apply it, we are binding with 40. So when I do partial of 2, I get 42. The difference between partial application and currying is, the key thing is, in currying, the function reduces to another function which accepts a single arity, and then with partial application, it need not be returning a function that accepts a single argument again. It's just partially applying. You could partially, if say we had a other math function which had n number of arguments, you could just partially apply n minus whatever you want. But in currying, it should always be 1 until you reach n. Is it clear? If you have any doubts, you could just ask me right away. Like, if it's not clear, I want some conversation again, please, guys. All right. So this was me. Yeah. Oh, all right. Okay. Can I switch to my terminal here and show it to them, or? I'm just hitting Babel, and that was it. But the question was to explain what arrow function is, what that single line actually is. So let's say the same example. Is it too small? All right. So this is what we were doing, right? So if you see at the right, Babel is translating the ES6 code to ES5. So something like sum, which is equal to A comma B, returns A plus B, would get in ES5 would be a simple function. So this is more of an abuse of an arrow function, I would say, because arrow function is meant for lexical binding. I'm not talking about lexical binding right now, but it's meant for that. Other thing, key thing you could keep in mind is, if your arrow function is just accepting one argument, you need not need those parentheses. You can just, and you need not read the, you need not need the return statement as well. So I say, say add 1 equals A and takes an argument and adds 1 to it. Then this thing on the left gets translated to right. That's how we would normally write, most of them would write it today, right? But if you're into ES6 already, it would be like this. All right. Thanks for the question, Santosh. Yeah. Okay. So the RGB thing. And this here is template literals. Projector is. Is that okay? You could still see it, right? Yeah, so so this is arrow functions returning other arrow functions. As you could see, R itself is a function, then whatever follows the arrow is again a function, so on and so forth. So if you see it to the right, RGBA, the first argument that it takes in is R, and then it returns a function, all right, which is expecting G, and then again it returns a function which is expecting B, and then again it returns a function which is expecting A. So finally it returns R plus GBA. R, why did the I missed the dollar there, or yeah, should have been all dollars. So dollar there expands into the expression in template literals, right? So I have the RGBA, so it finally concats RGBA and returns. It's clear? Say yes or no, guys. Say at least say one or zero. All right. So partial applications, and then this was me tweeting some days back, like Ayurveda and functional programming have something very much in similar. They have no side effects. That's their motto. At least that should have been the motto. So what are side effects? So console.log IO side effect. Console.log itself is a side effect. So what is a side effect? We all know what an effect is, a cause and effect, but this is a side effect what you see on the projector now. So the side effect is exactly that. So a program that is manipulating something outside its scope. So if console.log is printing something to the console, right? So it is changing the state of the console. So console.logs, whatever the function is doing inside, is changing the behavior outside. That itself is a side effect. So you could be wondering, like, how do I even code without having side effects? So I need to mention Haskell here, where they have a very good paradigm called the IO, where if there is a function which has a side effect, they would mention it in the signature saying, hey, this has a side effect. So writing the code which has absolutely no side effect is very, very hard, and it's not very practical, especially in JavaScript. So we need to take care of having less number of side effects that our program can have. That is because it's easier to debug. When you see the code, you could predict what it's doing and the mathematical correctness of it. So this is purity, the pure functions. Any function that doesn't have a side effect is a pure function. So if you can see here, I have a greet variable which says yo, and then I'm doing an uppercase on it, and still greet remains the same. The uppercase function isn't really modifying anything else, but it's creating a new string and returning the uppercase of that string, because greet is still small case yo. This is a pure function. So pure functions don't have side effects. So idempotency, you would have all heard this, like any function, say for example, let's not worry about the math apps. Let's say you have a sin x function and you pass sin 90 to it. You get a value 1. Is sin 90 1? Yeah. So you keep, no matter how many times you call sin 90, you still get 1. So that is an idempotent function. I hope my bank account was like that. I go to the ATM and I swipe a lakh of rupee. Like, every time I swipe, I get 1 lakh no matter what. So that doesn't really happen. So that's not an idempotent function, but this is an idempotent function. I know it's pretty early for some of them. Probably some of them used to get up now. I don't want to bother you with a lot of theory and concept, but trust me, when it gets to the live coding part, it'll be fun. So the point three, there's a point in point three. What point three is if you can see the two function calls, can you see some similarity or something strange in this? If anybody could say about it. All right. If you see, parse float and parse int are two functions which are expecting the numbers, right? But I'm mapping over them, but I'm not really passing those numbers to parse int or parse float. But still, we get the parsed int and parse float values, right? So that is the point three part of it. Point three in the sense your code doesn't really bother about parameters to pass to the function, right? So what parameters you are passing, you're not really specifying it. That's the point three part of it. It's pretty hard to get point three, but once you get the point three concept of functional programming, it'll be fun. So So the whole idea here is to use JavaScript and going functional with JavaScript. But if you get the, you finally have to get the functional way of thinking, right? So to that, you need to understand a bit of jargons and bit of math theory, bit of category theory, and everything summated together will make you help think functional, no matter in what programming language you're coding. Referential transparency. So what is referential transparency? Say you have a code which has something like idli and sambar, and there's one more function says which it says idli and sambar. So it finally returns invocation of idli and sambar. So for my friends who are not from India, I would definitely suggest you to try idli and sambar. So that's one of the ancient dishes of India, and it's free and open. There's no copyright. We don't know who really made the idli and sambar first. So coming to referential transparency. So if your code has something like this, any part in your code where there is a call for idli sambar, you could go ahead and replace it with idli sambar string. So finally, referential transparency means that part of the code which can be replaced by its value. What if I say to you that functions are values, right? In JavaScript, that's what, in functional programming, all functions are values, and something that a function that could be replaced by its value is referential transparency. Lazy evaluation. This is the closest we can get on lazy evaluation with JavaScript. This is using the ES6 generators. The star there is what makes the function a generator. I'm not going to go in depth of ES6 generator. There might be talks ahead which really talks about what ES6 is and how to go about it. So there is this random function which a random generator function which gives you an iterator on invocation, and doing a next on it will give you a random number. So what's the laziness part of it? So say let me give you an example. Say you want to generate numbers from 0 to n, where n is a billion, right? So if your code is generating 0 to n, where n is a billion, in a loop, it would take a long time, and it would be lazy. It will not be lazy, it will be slow. Laziness is the part where say you have 0 to billion, but you ask your program to give me 0 to 5. Then it will generate the 0 to 5 and give it to you, rather than having a billion in it and then giving only 5 out of it. So you get the point, right? Yeah. You have a question there? Okay. So lazy evaluation is with generators, this is the closest we can get. But the thing is, two things. One, there are programming languages which are purely functional, and there are programming languages which helps you to implement the functional style. JavaScript is on the left, so it kind of helps you to implement the functional style. With purely functional programming languages, every function will be curried by in itself, and the laziness is inbuilt. Tail recursion is one of that ES6 proposal that got in. Tail recursion is possible. Say you might have read recursion with the Fibonacci series, right? Most of us would have. So if you give a very huge number to your Fibonacci sequence, you will get a maximum call stack, right? Your stack would grow up and it would bomb. So with tail recursion, that would not really happen. With tail recursion, what happens is the code gets smart enough to be a bit lazy and take care of that recursive call so that it doesn't really bomb up, right? Some more. We have compose, where composition of functions. Say here we have a compose function which takes two functions f and g and returns one more function which is expecting the value x. Finally, it returns composition of function f with composition of function g. So if you have, say, if you have compose method which says compose x with y, it's like you can assume that it's evaluating from right to left. So it executes y first, whatever the value gets applied to x, and finally you get the result. So this is composition, and this will be very useful to write modular programs. That 7 points what I was speaking about. Immutability. So we saw an example of string there where yo greet equals yo and you did uppercase, right? The string was really not mutated. Mutated in the sense changing. So immutability is one such concept where you have to take care of not to change any parameters you receive or not to change any variables. This helps in the mathematical correctness of the part where you're not mutating anything. And statelessness. This is related to the first slide where I talk about bananas and gorillas and the entire forest, right? That is all the states that comes with the object. You just ask for an object banana, but you got the entire state, like is yellow, is vegetable, can I peel, has peel, like all these methods and all the states, and it's very huge. So you know, when you're thinking functionally, you have to see to reduce the state as much as possible. And if you have state, and you have to be very careful, like what React is doing with their states is a very good example of thinking functional and yet still having the states. So having a state, you have a state which is shared and it's mutable, then it's hell. So if you have a shared state, you have to see to that it's immutable. So these two are kind of connected. Yeah, I know. Talk is cheap. Show me the code. Alright, even before I start this, I want to talk about a small library that I'm using. Is it big enough? Ramda. So how many of you have tried Ramda here before? Couple of them, nice. So Ramda is one such library which really helps us to go functional with JavaScript. Why did I choose Ramda? There are a few things. One, the most important thing is every function in Ramda is curried. The way the code is implemented is very functional, and you get to see when I show you few examples. I would definitely suggest you to have a look at Ramda.js. There is the philosophy behind Ramda, and there's a wonderful post on philosophy behind Ramda, and I would definitely suggest you to see this video on hey underscore you're doing it wrong by Dr. Boolean. That's a really good talk. And is it big enough? All right. So this is a Ramda REPL on the web. So let me start with small examples and let's proceed with it and see how we could think functional with some live coding. So say you have an array of numbers. All right. So the task here is to just add one to each of them and return a resultant array. How would you do it with an imperative programming language, like imperative programming paradigm rather? So you would have a results array. Then you have a for loop. That's nothing to do with the for loop. The screen, yeah, and I think this is the right time to copy paste code. No, not really. Yeah. So you have a variable which starts an index that starts with 0, and probably you could cache the length as well. I'm not here right now. And what you would do is result dot push nums of I. You could either do the plus plus, but there's a lot of philosophy behind that as well. Like finally login result, I get 11, 21, 31, 41. This is how most of us would do with for loops, right? Yeah, thank you. I feel alive again. So if you have read the MDN docs for all the array methods, you would probably notice I would opt map and I would go and do it with map. So with map, you would, this is again the arrow function there. So you don't need the results at all. You take the number and map it over n and return n plus 1. Then I comment this out, I still get that. So you see the point there. We reduced having an variable called result, and that was getting mutated. So we reduced mutation, we reduced the variable. And then we were looping over, creating one more variable there and calculating the length. We reduced all of them. We reduced the entire thing to one single line with the map function. So we say map, and we just take each of them and add one to it, and map finally returns an array for us. Now talking about Ramda. The same map, if I do it with lambda, it would be this. Can you see the difference here? So the difference is in thing above lambda, we have the callback at the last. So we have numbers dot map, then the callback. But in lambda, we have the function first and the number next. So you might be thinking, what's the big deal about having the function first and the numbers next? I will just make it clear to you in a second. Say suppose I do this and call it add one. So this is function again, alright, and I could just say add one of nums. You see that? We have completely decoupled the add one, which is a function which doesn't even bother about what it's adding one to, right? It's a map function which is taking a function first and the argument next. So add one is like a create function which is waiting for its arguments. Because of this, composability is very much easy. That's why I've choose lambda. So far it's clear, right? So we started with numbers. All we had to do is add one to it. We tried with imperative coding where we looped over it and added one to it and pushed to the result. And then we did use map function, which JavaScript gives by native. And then we use lambda. And we are clear now with why lambda and why it's useful for composability in the functional way of coding. Let's go to the next example, where I have the filter example. Very much simple. We could reproduce the same thing again with having numbers array and then doing numbers dot filter and all. So here in this example, we have array 10, 20, 30, 300, 33 and 1. And what filter basically does is it checks for the condition where we are saying x greater than 10 on this list. So you want to filter a list which has you want to filter the list and get a resultant array which has only the numbers which are greater than 10. In our case, we got 20, 100 and 33. So this is a very simple example, but most of us would be doing it in our day-to-day life of coding, right? You have a huge JSON with you, you parse it, then you have to filter out few things, right? So this is how you could use a filter to filter out only those things which you need based on the condition. The condition there is x greater than 10. Then you have reduce. This is one of my favorite functions. So what reduce basically does is it takes a function, all right, and it takes an accumulator, all right, and then it takes a list. And it operates, it applies that function on the list over the accumulator. So if you see this example, it will be a bit clear. So what I'm doing is adding the list. So you have a list and you have to add all the numbers. So the accumulator starts with 0, right? And then you add the first number, that's 10 with 0, you get 10. And then you add 20 with 10, you get 30. And then you add 30 with 30, you get 60. And then you add 60 with 40, you get 100. So that's where the accumulator and the number goes in. If this is a bit confusing, you can call it n. So it's 100. Now, if you see, I'm starting the accumulator with 0 because I want to add all of them. So suppose I want to add 100 to each of them and then add all of them, I could just change the accumulator. So I got 200 or even 10, 110, right? And the fun part with accumulator is accumulator need not be just a number. It can be an object, it can be an array. So you can implement your reduce and filter, you can implement your map and filter with reduce. Then you have a similar thing called reduce, right? Where it's very much similar to reduce, but in reduce what's happening is we started from 10, 20, 30, right? That's from left to right. But this starts from right to left. If you see the strings which says BACKWRDS backwards, it started from right to left and concatenated them and we got backwards string. That's reduce, right? Transreduce is one of lambda's function, but it's a functional concept as a whole. But let's see a small example. The compose part, what I was saying, the f of g, remember that function which takes a function and returns a function calling the function, applying it. I know it's a lot of jargons and mouthful of words, but the code makes it clear. So what we are doing in compose is r dot prop will probably is picking up the price from the purchases, right? So compose happens from right to left. So you pick up the price and default it to zero. So it's price or zero. Either you have the price or it is zero. What transreduce basically does is it acts upon the purchases starting with zero and adds all of them, and we are mapping with price or zero. Why you are mapping with price of zero is in this purchases, if you notice, there is not a price, which is a cow. But if you have written this in an imperative style, it would have bombed saying that it can't add cow to a number, or rather it would add cow to a number and you would end up with a string having 30, 0, cow, 10, 6, right? But here it won't really bomb that way, and the result is 46. What's happening there is, again, in transreduce, it acts on the purchases and it starts with 0, adds all of the values and maps over price of 0, because if it's not a price, then we would get 0. Clear? Currying. So here's one more example of curried function. We have ABC and we are returning A plus B into C. Rather, this would also work. You don't need the parentheses just for the readability. So if you do 2, 3, we would end up with one more function. If you see here, we have a function. So it's like 2 plus 3. It's waiting for C. Now you will pass in C, you get the result. So this helps in composability, and why currying matters is when you have a function which is expecting number of functions, and you have at the current instance you have only 3 parameters to pass to it, or in this case we have only 2 parameters to pass to it. We could pass to it and get another function which is expecting the last argument, and we could use that as a generic function throughout our code anywhere. Compose, yeah, I think by now compose you should be clear. Compose will always act from right to left. Here we have numbers 2, 3, 4, 5. We are filtering it out, the filter part which we saw in the example. We are filtering it out with x greater than 4, so we would get 5. And then we are mapping over it and multiplying it with itself, as in like squaring it. So you get 25. That's the compose part. There is one more function called pipe. So what pipe basically does is, I've been saying that compose, you can think of it as acting from right to left, right? Pipe is like your Unix pipe. You could have done an ls-l and pipe with wc-c to know how many lines you have, right? Or l. So you know that pipe character what we have. So pipe function works similar to your pipe character here. The function on the left is applied first, and whatever result is get passed to the right one, and whatever result finally comes out is the final result. So same function as compose. We are filtering with x greater than 4 and mapping in compose, but here we map and then filter. So here we are getting 9, 16 and 25. In the previous one we were getting just 25. Clear? Exactly. So he said basically it's L to R and R to L processing. That's an easy way to remember it. But I normally go with pipe, as in the Unix pipe where it happens from left to right. Alright. Let's go back to the slides again. How good am I doing at the time? All right. So talk is cheap, and show me the code. You're done things. Okay. Let's talk about category theory. Some more theory. And Sheldon is smiling bullshit there. All right. I want to talk about some basic math, some 5th, 6th grade math again, because what happens is we normally get into programming and think, hey, programming doesn't really involve the math, theorems and axioms that I had learned, but not really. Let's just quickly refresh few of the math theory, the math fundamental rather. We have associative law, where idli plus sambar into chutney is nothing but idli plus sambar into chutney. And then we have commutative law, where idli plus chutney is chutney plus idli. And then we have identity, that all our milkman knows this, that milk plus water is more milk, is milk again. And we have distributive, where you could mix your milk with sugar and chocolate, adding sugar and chocolate together and adding milk to it, or mixing sugar with milk and then mixing chocolate with milk and adding them both together, it's the same thing. Was it very fast, or you want to just, you all remember your math? So category is just a collection of same type. In JavaScript, we could say an array of integers is a category in itself. Category in one slide. So there is this setoid. Anything which is a setoid implements reflective, symmetric, and transitive laws. So you could say A equals A is reflective, and A equals B equals A, that's symmetric and transitive. So anything that's a setoid implement these three laws. And a semigroup kind of implements associative law and concat method. And there's something called as monoid, which implements right identity, left identity, and an empty method. You could see on it's basically implementing the concat from semigroup. A concat B concat C is equivalent to A concat of B concat of C. That's what I was talking about, the milk and the chocolate thing. It's the same semigroup. And then you have monoid, which implements the right identity, left identity, and the empty method in it. Then we have functor. Functor is anything that has map in it. So your array itself is a functor. So anything that's mappable is basically functor, which implements identity and composition. And apply basically is a functor, but which also implements composition in a way that we saw that RGB example, right? Similar to that, but here we have also have this AP method that gets implemented in it. Then we have applicative. Applicative has identity, homomorphism, and interchange. You might be thinking about what homomorphism is. It's very easy to guess, right? Homo is like single, and morph is to modify. So it kind of operates on only one kind of category and modifies it. And then we have chain. If you have been using Lodash or underscore, you would have been doing chain function, right? Like chaining of things. This is one of the anything that implements the chain will also have associativity in it. So you might be wondering, why is he talking so much of theory of math, all this semigroup, monoid, applicative, functor? What's all this? So all these things is needed for you to understand what a monad is. So a monad is just a monoid in the category of endofunctors. That's a mouthful. But yeah, what's the problem? The professor asks. But if you want to understand what a monad is, you should get all these concepts of semigroup, applicative, functor, and whatever I spoke about. So monad basically implements the chain with the left identity and the right identity. The fun part with monad is, if a person really understands monad, he can't really explain it to anybody. So if I failed to explain what a monad is, that means I've got what monad is. All right. So this is what I talked right now was known as the fantasy land spec. So what fantasy land spec is, suppose you want to write your own functional programming language, you go and implement that spec. So that spec, I tried to boil down it to a single image. Here I have a semigroup which has concat, that's what I was talking about. If it is a semigroup, which it will have a concat in it, and of course the loss which I mentioned. And then we have the monoid which has concat and empty in it. And then we have the functor which is map, and apply which has map and apply, and so on. I didn't mention about foldable and transformable, that's nothing but your reduce and lift. So that's the fantasy land spec in one image. That was too much of theory, isn't it? Like a lot of category theory. So this, you might be wondering, like where would the category theory be useful? Where exactly the term monad will be useful? There's an argument that people say jQuery is a monad, and some set of people say jQuery is not a monad. So you could go and read those articles where people try to prove that jQuery is a monad. So here is an example called a maybe monad. So the idea of functional programming is to reduce statements into functions. Rather, what we would be used to do is, if there is something which is very repetitive, we would probably boil down it to a function, right? So, but in functional programming, it's about, say you have a for loop and you have an if and else, and that was a bell ringing, like the school is going to end kind of thing. And then you have a you have an if and else condition and a try and catch thing, right? The whole branching statement and the whole statements gets converted to a function in a functional programming language, rather than repeated statements getting into a function, right? This is an example of a maybe monad, where what maybe just is like, it's just or nothing. As in, I'll try to give an example as I go further. Like when we have a maybe monad which says, maybe I might get a string, or I might get an null, I might get an integer, I don't know, just try to do this operation. This kind of things we really do, right? We do this null check. If x is not equal to null, then do this. Then again, y is not equal to null, then do this. This kind of a conditional check is normally there in our functions, right? So with maybe you can say, maybe I will get a string. If I get a string, then go ahead and do this operation. If not, just return null. So you reduce the whole branching statements and the whole conditional statement into a simple function that would take care of all your exceptions and returning the right values. And lenses is one such concept. Say you have your huge JSON I was talking about, and you want to get and set. Normally what we do with objects is either you get or you set, or you see whether that value exists or not, right? So lenses is one such concept which helps you to set, view, and run a function over a particular attribute of a function. Say you have an object which has a person, or you have a person object which has a name, say Hemant, and then age, and then blah blah blah, so many other attributes. So you want to just modify the age thing. So you would create a lens on the object for age, and you could set the value to whatever value you want, or you could view whether what's the value of the age, or you could run a function on over it. So lenses is also one of the monad. And promise, of course, most of you would have heard what promises are. Promises also is a monad. So with or without our being aware, we have already been using the concept of monads, but it's very much important to understand what a monad is, and to understand what a monad is, you have to understand endofunctors, monoid and semigroup and setoid and functors and all the things I mentioned. That would really help you to go to the next level in the functional way of thinking. This is a list of functional programming libraries we have. This is one of my friends who has collected it. It's on GitHub. I'll share you the link, and I'm also contributing to this list. In this list, there is Lodash and Lodash FP. Lodash FP is this new library that Lodash community has kind of got influenced by RAMD, I would say, to have an Lodash FP, that's FP as in functional programming, which also has autocurrying and which also takes functions as the first parameter, like RAMD does. And if you see the that library called 101, that's also from me and my friends, where we have one-liners. One-liners is kind of influenced by 101, and one-liners is that library which me and my friends have done, which have ES6 one-liners, which are all functional. You have map, reduce, and whatever I was speaking about, like pick and prop, all of them, and it's just defined in one line. So you could just go to GitHub and look for one-liners. And FPJS and FPDOM is also an effort from me and my friends on, the idea was to make DOM functional. So you could do a document.query selector in a more functional way, and all the document related and DOM related functions in a functional paradigm. So the helper function for FPDOM was FPJS. So I would suggest you to go and look into these libraries. How would I want that? I have 2 more minutes, so I'll probably get into the questions. And if you could see that image, it's from the movie Bahubali, so I don't really know why Kattappa killed Bahubali. But I can just answer other questions. I'll try to.
Hi. Thanks for the talk. I have a question. What would be the trade-offs between choosing one of these libraries which you mentioned, or the one we showed, versus a pure functional language like ClojureScript?
So that's a very good question. So the question was, what is the trade-off between using one of the libraries I mentioned versus something which is purely functional? The trade-off is, one thing is, all the functions there in a purely function programming like Haskell already gives you the maybe monad implemented in the GSCI itself, and the concept of currying, the auto currying is done. by all the functions are auto-carried by itself in default. And then we have lazy evaluations and things like all these functional paradigms are already implemented bare minimal in the shell for you. But if you're using functions, the libraries like this, the trade-off would be you have to, first thing is you have to have this as a dependency for your project. And the second thing is not every functional paradigm is implemented in it. For example, whatever RAMD I was talking about doesn't have the maybe monad. So if you want the maybe, you have to go and include RAMD fantasy. That is RAMD with the fantasy land spec. So the trade-off would be having those dependencies, but the fun part is you could still get a bit more functional.
Thank you.
Hi, great talk, by the way. So I just realized, I just realized you talked a lot about mathematical proving using Haskell, and you touched quite a bit about it. So I was asking, I wanted to ask you about how realistically possible it is to actually implement it. For example, I would argue that if I want to just actually write a proof, a lemma, that I need to implement a red-black tree, a very small portion, I need to prove it through my code, writing a proof theorem, right? So it will be much easier or less time-consuming than Haskell to write it in COQ, COQ, or maybe in OCaml, right?
Yeah.
In Haskell, because it's like, first, it's non-terminating, right? So that might prove some problems. Like, what's your thought on that?
Yeah, that's a good question. But whatever programming languages you mentioned are purely functional.
Yes, right? Are specifically used for
correct, functional
proofing.
Yeah. That's what I'm adding on to that. So if you consider JavaScript, as I've been mentioning, it's a multi-paradigm language. So the mathematical correctness is what I would say. Say you have, let's have a contrast of you're reading a file and you have to look for certain, pass the file and look for certain strings in it, all right? And then you have to collect all these frequencies of those strings in the file. Compare it with an imperative programming language with the functional way of thinking it, having more functions and composing it. It's a very simple example, as you told about the AV tree or the black tree. This is even more a trivial example which gives a bit of clarity. So here you have your imperative code where there are a lot of loops running over the files, you're reading the file, you're checking whether the file exists or not, you're throwing an exception. So many things to consider in a small function, in a small little util rather. On the other contrast, when you're doing it in the functional way, right? For example, the maybe monad style, like you have the maybe, you check, I have the file, maybe, if I have the file, then go ahead, then read it, then do a filter on it, do a map, and then concat it and give me the result, or just give me the object, do a filter and do a reduce and give me an object, right? So something very trivial as this, when you write it in a functional way, when you're designing it, you could just think, so have this function, I would probably compose it later on, so let me have this function. And let me have other function. So all of this, all are the set of functions, right? Which you could prove mathematically right even before you go and implement it. You are damn sure that maybe will not fail because maybe will rather give you the file or it will give you null, right? That's one of the main concept why function got hot is we have a processor with multiple cores in it these days. Rather than having a higher frequency processor and multiple processor in itself. We have a processor which has multiple cores, but JavaScript being a single thread, you could still, if your function is composable, you could pass those functions to each of the cores and then get it computed and then get the result, right? That's why the functional way of thinking or the functional programming is getting hot these days.
Yeah, we're going to have to wrap this talk up right here.
Yeah.
So thank you, Hemant.
Thank you, guys. It was a wonderful session.